Pap smear is the topic. And pap smear is a highly important diagnostic tool to detect cervical cancer. And every year, there's 500,000 new cases of cervical cancer worldwide. And about half of these, unfortunately, result in death. So cervical cancer is a very significant cause of cancer-related mortality. The good news, however, is that the incidence over the past 30 years or so has decreased by 50% incidence of cervical cancer. And this is essentially thanks to pap smears. Pap smear, of course, as I mentioned, is a cervical cancer screening test. And essentially what you're doing with this test is you're taking cells from the cervix and you're examining them under a microscope. And what that allows you to do is it allows you to look if there's any abnormality in these cells. And if there is abnormality, if you do see abnormal cells, you can do more specific tests such as a colposcopy and a biopsy. And then sometimes more frequent pap smears that are done a little bit more often. Now, essentially what you're trying to do with pap smears is prevent cervical cancer by diagnosing and treating cervical cancer precursors. So I'll explain what that really means. See, when you have a cervical cell, it doesn't go directly to becoming a cancer cell in one shot. That doesn't happen. What happens actually is a normal cervical cell will go through several stages. So I'll put in a bunch of them in here. So here you have the normal cell. And it'll go through several stages before it ends up to be that cancerous cell. And these stages are described in a lot of terminology. There's ascus, atypical squamous cells. There's LGSIL, low-grade squamous intraepithelial lesion. And there's high-grade squamous intraepithelial lesions. These are often described as dysplasia, mild dysplasia, moderate dysplasia, and severe dysplasia. So what the pap smear is doing is trying to catch these cells. So basically you're trying to catch these cervical cancer precursors that you can then treat before they progress to full-blown cervical cancer. Important point is 99% of these cancer cells or cervical cancer cases are due to a virus known as HPV, human papilloma virus. So that's often tested quite a bit on clinical vignettes. Now let's talk a little bit about the screening in terms of when you should do it. The thing is, the cervical cancer screening has changed so many times over the years that I have to actually look at, what is the current recommendation. And here it is. The current recommendation, at least in North America, is begin at age 21, regardless of sexual activity. Because before they used to say only when the person becomes sexually active, but that's not regarded as part of the recommendations anymore. Begin at age 21, regardless. And then from age 21 to 65, do a pap smear every 3 years. That it used to be one. Sometimes I used to hear two, but this is the current guideline. And then after a hysterectomy, if a woman has had one, you don't need to do a pap smear anymore because the cervix is gone, so there's nothing to actually take a sample of. So these are the current guidelines. I just looked them up. And before I get to some clinical vignettes, I want to actually draw a little bit of anatomy to explain how this technique is done. This is a cervix, and this opening here is known as a cervical os, OS, and this canal in here is known as the endocervical canal. When you do a pap smear, very first thing you need to do is sample cells from the ectocervix. So this area right here, this area. And that's done with a spatula, a small specific spatula that's used during a pap smear. Then what you do, then after that you insert a small brush into the canal and sample the endocervix. So that brush, of course, would go in here. So that's the proper technique of doing a pap smear. Well, let's take a look at some vignettes. 27-year-old woman comes to the office for a periodic health maintenance exam. She is a healthy patient with great habits. She exercises 3 times a week, takes 1500 milligrams of calcium, does not drink or smoke, eats a low fat, high fiber diet. Her last pap smear, which was 2 years ago, was normal, and her blood pressure, body mass index, and non-fasting cholesterol have all been stable. Focused physical exam is unremarkable. You decide that a complete pelvic exam is indicated at this appointment. External genitalia, vagina, and cervix appear normal. Most appropriate next step is. Okay, well, the thing is, a lot of times these screening tests change so much that it's rather unfortunate. But by the current guidelines, of course, she would only require a pap smear every 3 years. This question was written a few years ago, so what they're basically saying is that she should have a pap smear now. I know it's a little confusing, but basically that's what they're getting at. And what they're saying is, when you do a pap smear, what do you do first? Do you sample the endocervix first or the ectocervix? And the answer, of course, is you sample the outside first, which is the ectocervix. If you do a chlamydia and gonorrhea culture, that's fine, but that would be done after you do the pap smear. Next question. 26-year-old psych resident comes to the office for a periodic health maintenance exam. She's in excellent health, marathon runner, takes calcium every day. She reports that she had an appendectomy at age 14, dilation curettage for elective abortion at age 23. She's currently in a monogamous sexual relationship with a coworker and uses a combined oral contraceptive pill. She has no history of STDs and reports having a normal pap every year since age 16. Physical exam is unremarkable. You spend time explaining the self-breast exam and doing general health maintenance counseling. 2 weeks later, her pap results taken that day are returned. And return as low-grade squamous intraepithelial lesion, LGSIL. You call her to inform that she will need to return for a colposcopic evaluation. In speaking to her about these results, it would be appropriate to explain that. Okay, well, LGSIL is fortunately mild dysplasia. And the good news is that most paps that have LGSIL will spontaneously become normal. Only about a small number, 10%, will go and progress. So although it is a good idea to have a colposcopy, you could tell her to have pap smears a little more often. So every 6 months, for example. So that is an acceptable approach. So the answer to this question, interestingly, is A. Most of these lesions will progress to HGSIL. Most won't, only 10% will. These results are consistent with cervical intraepithelial neoplasia too. That's not correct. And you certainly don't need to go out and sample her endometrium. And the last one, 51-year-old woman comes with chronic back pain. She's been a patient for a number of years, but you've not seen her for 2 years. Her last menstrual period was 9 months ago. She's not sexually active. She had a cholecystectomy at age 43, ovarian cyst removal at age 23. Family history is remarkable for a father who died of MI at 59, a mother who was alive and well. Sister and aunt both died of breast cancer. Father and her grandfather had diabetes. Physical exam is unremarkable. Concerning her risk for cervical cancer, most appropriate management is. Well, again, this goes to our guidelines. Basically, any woman from 21 to 65 should have a pap smear every 3 years. So let's see if that's one of the answer choices. Bimanual exams annually. No, she needs to have a pap smear. Colposcopy every 1 to 3 years. Well, not necessarily. Maybe if the pap smear showed some abnormalities, but not most appropriate. No screening is necessary, as this patient is postmenopausal. That's not true. She's 51. We don't really go by postmenopausal or premenopausal. We go by age. No screening is necessary based upon her age. Not true. So even without looking at the last answer, we've narrowed it down to that. But it is true. Pap smear testing every 1 to 3 years. And the actual specific number is 3 years. So the answer to this question is E.